You got enormous experience in your field. Thank you, sir. Now we move on to a very important topic and also the practical topic, which I mean, very few of us had this kind of experience. Now I call upon Dr. G.R. Magadevan. He has got an enormous experience with the COVID-19 of more than 200 cases. So now I welcome Dr. Magadevan to deliver the lecture.
Good evening, sir. Thank you, sir. Good evening to all the respected IMA members. So today I'll be summarizing about my experience in the last 2 months with these patients. And I would not be going into the details of which drug is better or the debate would be kept aside. So I am a critical care physician in Muir Hospitals, as well as I manage the critical care COVID block there, including the wards as well as the ICU. So our journey, which started from the end of March when we received our first patient of COVID-19, which was diagnosed outside, and they came as a family, as a young couple with two kids. And they were offered a ward care, and they were there for about 2 weeks, and they successfully went. So the discussion for today would be our journey and how we triage and organize the beds, how we classify these patients on a severity basis, and what kind of treatment we have offered for these patients, and the outcomes and take-home message. So far, we have seen around 500 cases, out of which 200 patients have been discharged. So since it's a tertiary care center and a main COVID referral center, we have referrals from all parts of Chennai and some said even outside Chennai for treatment. We have mild, moderate and severe patients. So we have a dedicated building for this and a dedicated ER with an ER staff. So on arrival, we classify them on mild, moderate and severe. The mild category would be admitted in the general wards or in a private room according to the availability. And the moderate and the severe ones will come to the intensive care unit. So this is a normal presentation of a mild COVID-19 patient. Very often the patient is walking comfortably, may have a history of a low-grade fever or a cough. Anosmia is very, very common, especially in women. And generalized myalgia, malaise. Chest X-ray is mostly normal. There is no hypoxia, saturation is mostly around 98-97%. And since we classify them as mild, we do not put any major comorbid patients in this category. And diarrhea is also very common. So here we see the CT findings of a patient with a mild, where we have minimal infiltrates or a mild peripheral ground glass opacities seen here. This is a very, very common finding. And the CT finding is picked up even before the RT-PCR comes into place. And just because they have findings in the CT, doesn't mean that they all have hypoxia or lung symptoms. We have a lot of patients without any cough or breathing difficulty, but they have a significant CT findings or chest X-ray things. So what treatment we offer for the mild COVID-19 patients? Adequate oral hydration or IV fluids if the patient is having any vomiting or loose stools. Paracetamol, SOS, azithromycin with a PPI, and the HCQ if there is no contraindication like QT prolongation, control of blood sugars and BP as in any other patient. The average stay in a hospital is around 5 days at present. The initial guidelines was we need to keep the patient for about 14 days and then have 2 negative reports and then discharge the patient. So currently, the corporation is okay with if they keep the patient for 5 days, if they are completely asymptomatic, there are no new issues, they can go home and continue home isolation. Next, coming to the moderate category of COVID-19. So very often we see patients with bilateral chest infiltrates, which is worsening either in CT or in chest X-ray, the saturation of less than 94%. Sometimes they have breathlessness, they are tachypneic, and they have other comorbidities like uncontrolled diabetes, obesity and all that. Most of these patients do not have any shock or any other organ dysfunctions. So these patients most likely will land up in the ICU. Either this patient can be referred from outside hospital or our own patient can become can progress to a moderate from a milder disease and then land up in the ICU. So other than the routine set of investigations, what we do here, we do the ferritin, CRP and D-dimer, which is mostly elevated, or it correlates with the severity. It cannot predict the patient getting bad or not, but it often correlates with the severity. So procalcitonin is mostly normal, and IL-6 levels, again, it correlates with the severity of a cytokine storm, and it cannot predict a patient whether it can get him better or not. So, and chest, CT chest is not routinely advised. So CT chest can be considered if you want to do rule out an alternative diagnosis. So again, the treatment would be, hydration is very important, oxygen support. So there are various supports of modalities by which oxygen delivery can be given. One is a simple face mask. Other one is a non-rebreathing mask, an NRBM, what we say, non-invasive ventilation, and a high flow nasal concentration. A high flow nasal concentration is a device where we can give deliver oxygen with very high concentrations, even up to about 60 liters per minute. So individualizing the patient, which patient needs which kind of a modality, is very, very important. And there is an increasingly promising results with awake proning, which I'll be discussing further next slide. Anticoagulation is mostly given for all the moderate and severe patients. And we have been using methylprednisolone about 1 mg per kg body weight for all the moderate patients and the severe ones. Most of the patients recover at this stage. Some do progress to the severe, and the average stay for these kind of patients would be about 4 to 5 days in the ICU. So here we see a CT scan of a very severe COVID patient. So as I mentioned before, see, this CT scan is not routinely done. Sometimes we have to rule out if there is an alternative diagnosis or some other pathology going ahead with this patient. So these kind of severe COVID-19, they have a severe respiratory distress. Saturation is mostly less than 80s, even with oxygen of the previous, the modalities what I discussed, like an NIV or even mechanical ventilation or high flow nasal pro oxygen. So tachypnea, patient is often tachycardic. Invasive ventilation is given, is considered, but not for all patients. So obesity patients, uncontrolled diabetes, and previous CAD with a cardiac failure do not do well. And there is no age correlation. We have patients going into a severe, even in the age of 35, 40, even in the age of 70, 80s. And less than females. Surprisingly, we are not seeing much of this thing, luckily, in the females. And the most interesting part here is the numbers don't matter. We often see patients, even with a saturation of 70%, looking very stable, and sometimes patient with about 80% going in for a severe respiratory distress and gasping and all this. And most often, we do not see patients in shock. We do not see patients in a multi-organ dysfunction. We do not see patients with severe metabolic acidosis or the lactates going up, as we see in the other tropical diseases like dengue, leptospirosis, or scrub typhus, or even bad enteric fever or perforation and all that. So again, the treatment, choosing the right modality of oxygen delivery is very, very vital. Some patients can do well with a tight-fitting NIV mask, such as an obese patient or a previous history of an obstructive sleep apnea. Some patients do very well with just an NRPM mask and in the prone position, especially thin-built individuals. So here the individualized care is the key, and it is very, very important. And we cannot just go by numbers alone. For example, if the saturation is less than 80%, we put them on NIV. If the saturation is less than 70%, we put them on mechanical ventilation. It doesn't work that way. So knowing your patient and what is the kind of distress is very, very important. And if the patient goes in for a shock, always look for a secondary infection. It can be a secondary bacterial infection or a cardiogenic shock, which comes out in the presence of this viral. So as I told you, methylprednisolone has been used widely in the moderate cases, which also progress sometimes to the severe ones. And we have also used a lot of tocilizumab, where we suspect IL-6 levels going up, or we suspect a cytokine storm and we use this drug. So most of these patients, that is a severe COVID-19, who come around, they take a time of around 7 to 10 days is the usual time. So having said that, there are a lot of patients where the chest X-ray is really bad. We don't see any black opacities there at all. And they require oxygen about 4 liters or 5 liters. They stay in the ICU for even 2 weeks. So, and the routine anticoagulation is given for all these patients, either moderate and severe. So there is a lot of evidence in proning. Even the previously, even for ventilated patients, there's a lot of evidence with proning. So similar applies to the awake proning also. Even if the patient is not mechanically ventilated, even if the patient is not in the invasive ventilation, if the patient is conscious and cooperative, we can very well try this awake proning. And it is given us very good results, even with a normal face mask or an NRBM or hypronasal proxy. What we see here is a high flow HFNC connected to the patient. So most these patients has to be conscious and cooperative. Almost every bed in our ICU, the patient will be in this kind of a situation, and it does improve the oxygenation. Typically, the saturation might be around 65 to 70 in a supine position. And the patient, once they start proning themselves, the saturation can go up to about 80 or even 95%. And they do go out of the ICU successfully. So there are some theories how would this thing is, that is, it reduces the basal atelectasis, the gas exchange is better, the weight of the heart does not come on the lungs, and the diaphragm again is free to for the lung movement to act. And so this phenomenon where many of this is very popular, happy hypoxia. So it is very true that these patients are conscious, they do not complain of breathlessness, they are comfortable, the numbers are looking bad, the X-ray is really looking bad, and they are happily eating and they are comfortable. So again, these patients, we don't know what to do. So we just put them on the oxygen and we wait and watch. They also recover and they go home by about 5 to 7 days. So what we need most is the stigma and the optimism has to be improved. So as the other, Dr. Sandeep said, coverall suit and N95 shield, a designated donning and doffing area, regular training for the staff and regular breaks is definitely required. So to summarize, what we have learned in this 2 months is most of the moderate and severe patients, they recover. Saturation is just a number, and this COVID breaks all kinds of rules. You don't see patients with tachycardia or in shock or in cyanosis or getting mentally disturbed or mental confusion with hypoxia. There is no organ damage seen in most of these patients. Most of their kidney function is fine. The liver function is fine. The echoes are fine. They just have a hypoxia. And steroids and teplizumab have been helpful, although we have seen patients improving without teplizumab. And COVID-19 by itself, since it's breaking all rules, can become a specialty. And the most important point is careful selection of candidates for home isolation. We cannot blindly say very often we see patients coming as families. Most of the patients, they don't come as individual. The father might come first, then the daughter, then the son, then the wife, then the grandmother. So we have to choose home isolation mostly for the younger ones and people with comorbidities. It is better they stay in the hospital for a minimum of 4 to 5 days. Once they are completely asymptomatic, we can discharge them. They can come as an outpatient basis, obviously with a separate area, dedicated area for that, and it can be treated. Because most often we do see patients who are completely asymptomatic in the first week, and then they start developing symptoms like a high-grade fever or a hypoxia, which can go unnoticed. And the other most important things which we are seeing in the last 1 week is we see a lot of patients being referred from other hospitals in a very, very bad shape. So till beyond a point, they may not be able to manage, and the patient is referred all of a sudden, and they come to the ER with saturation of 40, and we also get helpless because we don't know what is the background of the patient and what is the treatment they can go up to, what is the level of care we can give. There is no time Because as I told you, that treatment has to be individualized, and we need to analyze which patient needs what kind of oxygen modality. Thank you.
Thank you, Mahadevan sir. You got a nice experience. And I want to ask two questions, sir. One, if the test shows, that is called the RT-PCR shows negative, how often you see a patient with a CT finding, bilateral, hourglass, bone glass experience, appearance?
Very
that
often,
is,
sir.
That,
very
that
often.
That is one question, sir. The another question, in your series, 200 cases, how many patients has underwent ventilator?
When I prepared this slide, it was around last week, it was mentioned about 200. Now we've almost reached 500 patients. So we have ventilated about 10 cases out of that.
So and, 10 cases out of 500, right?
Around 10 patients we have ventilated at this point of time. Mostly, the moment they are ventilated, they have to go for a prone position. We have not ventilated the real bad ones. That is, when the patient comes to the ER in a very bad shape and you don't have time to even respond, the patient has got a background of severe, some metastasis, or already the patient is in a bedridden state. Those kind of patients we have not ventilated. The patients whom they are really deserving, young, and who might, the good chances of recovery is there, we have ventilated, and there have been positive results also. And coming to your first question, sir,
yes.
We have seen quite a lot of patients where the RT-PCR comes negative. The patient has a history of a contact, or the patient has clinical symptoms which fit into COVID. And on doing a CT scan, we have picked up ground glass opacities. And on repeating the RT-PCR after some time, it has turned out positive also.
Sir, I'm Dr. Varadarajan. In those who are ventilated, is the mortality more?
Yes, sir.
Can I ask one question, sir? About hydroxychloroquine as a prophylaxis or as a part of treatment, what's your opinion, sir? We recently heard news of a loss of a young girl in a hostel due to hydroxychloroquine. What's your opinion?
Hydroxychloroquine, there is no clear-cut benefits in all these random in-country trials, sir. ICMR has been recommending HCQ in a big way, but still in our practice, we are seeing more of side effects and minimal side effects, not up to a life-threatening one. And personally, I don't think so it helps.
Next question is the role of remdesivir.
Remdesivir has been shown some promising effects. We have been trying to procure the drug. The drug is still not available in India.
I see. And you said about putting the patient in prone position. Is it prone, complete prone, or semi-prone?
It can be a complete prone position, or it can be even repositioning. That is, the patient can be in left lateral or in the right lateral.
Okay.
So where the atelectasis is avoided and the oxygen level, that is the gas exchange, is much better. It can be even in the semi-prone, because most of the patients who are obese may not be able to go on a complete prone. So it can be even a semi-prone.
Okay. In a primitive institution, they are giving zinc and vitamin C as part of the treatment. Your opinion on it, sir?
I am also using zinc and vitamin C, sir.
It's not shown in your document.
It is not shown in your document, sir, but we are also using zinc and vitamin C. Most of the time, our patients, they ask for vitamins and vitamin C. And they also, you know, unless the patient is in the ICU, they all have their phone in their hands and they constantly, they do their own research. So we give them routine zinc and vitamin C.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Is the indication for tocilizumab based on IL-6 levels or on the clinical conditions, sir?
It is on the clinical condition, sir. It is not based on the IL-6 alone. If the patient is clinically worsening, after about 5 to 7 days of coming to the hospital, and you see suddenly there's worsening, and overtly the patient is tachypneic and tachycardic, where then we give tocilizumab. Even before the patient goes into the ventilator, we give the tocilizumab, and it has shown some promising effects.
Thank you.
Sir, what is the duration of home quarantine you advise when you discharge a mild case?
14 days, sir. we believe that the virus, the virulence of the virus and the patient cannot be infected beyond a particular point. Although we cannot, it is not a hard and fast rule, and nobody can guarantee that the patient may not infect. We said self-isolation in your own room for about 14 days. Most often the patient, they ask whether we need to be tested so that we can mingle with the rest of the family. Again, the patient, most of the patients, they remain positive for even up to 30 days. So our initial patients were all positive for a very long time. And then the government said that we need not test them to discharge them. Once they're asymptomatic for about 5 days, you can discharge them.
Can I ask just a question about in the herbal treatment, Kapasura Kudinir, they're popularizing, no? Your opinion on it, sir?
I don't know, sir.
Okay.
How about in diarrhea cases, some guys are using in this probiotics. Do you think, is there any value?
Sir, probiotics has been extensively used, but I have attended your own meeting where you said probiotics is not useful for anything. So,
but yeah, but you know, I heard some people using it successfully. And this Chinese literature also had said that diarrhea manifestations are very responsive to probiotics. That's why I asked this question.
Sir, it is very, very self-limiting diarrhea, and they don't have a large quantity of watery stools. So, can be used, sir. Probiotics. We are also using probiotics, sir. Okay. And very often, we give azithromycin also, and we are not sure whether the patient has got loose stools because of our own treatment or because of the COVID itself. But probiotics, we are giving, sir.
Sir,
zinc and vitamin C also, they say you can't be giving for too long a time. I think Ehlerson doctor can also advise, because we have been, some people have been continuously taking. They say it's harmful. Zinc too long a time is harmful.
Yes, we give, as long as the patient is there in the hospital, we give. And then we just...
as a prophylaxis, people are taking nowadays. So that is not recommended, they say, for a long time. Can Ehlerson sir answer?
No, I think some people are trying to overdose, you know, trying to take 2 grams, 3 grams, and, you know, all kinds of very high doses. We have no evidences like that. At least as long as people stick to recommended dietary allowance or maximum of 500 milligrams of vitamin C, it should be sufficient. As far as zinc is concerned, 15 milligrams is fine enough. And people sometimes, you know, they use 30, 40. It's all, it starts producing nausea and diarrhea. You know, you could start.
No, 15 milligrams, okay, sir. How long?
Yeah, there is nothing like a particular cutoff period. Because, you know, there is nothing like a zinc accumulation and zinc toxemia and things like that. So, if you don't overdose in a day, as long as you stick to, you know, somewhere in the periphery of recommended dietary allowance, you are safe. And
so 150 milligrams of vitamin C is also adequate, no sir?
Yeah, it should be adequate.
Right.
And not more than 500.
Sir, regarding zinc, you know, regarding zinc, only in commercial preparation, you don't have a only particularly specifically zinc tablet. You have zinc combination only. Yeah, because in the zincovit, you have somewhere around 75. Then another table, another prescription, generic, you have a zinc tablet. Sir, what is your opinion regarding this, sir? Mahadevan?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Regarding the zinc dosage.
Yeah, zinc dose, because it is comes in the only the multivitamin form. You will not get it in a pure zinc tablet. You will not, like a vitamin C tablet, you are not getting a pure zinc tablet.
It is true, sir. We don't have separate zinc tablets. It is often given as a multivitamin dose only.
Yeah,
maximum correct. Day we give for about 10 days, sir. Beyond that, we don't give.
Any other questions, sir? Can we move on to next subject?
Dr. Samir, yes, to Dr. Mahadevan.
Yes.
Are you seeing different kinds of virulence patterns, sir? Is it true that there are people say there are different strains and different types of virulence?
Sir, it is possible. Initially, we started seeing clusters, that is more from the Coimbatore and more from North Madras. Now, we have patients from all parts of Chennai. and why some patients they go bad, why some patients are completely asymptomatic, it is very difficult to say. So we don't know into the microbiology part of it, but I do see that it is completely unpredictable why some patients don't do well. There are a lot of patients who are obese, they do successfully, they go home, and a lot of uncontrolled diabetes, they do well. A lot of patients with 80 years and 90 years, they do well, where there's like their own son who's about like 60 years or 65 years, they don't do very well. It is something which needs more clarity, which I'm not able to predict at this point of time, sir.
Sir, there are two questions from one Dr. Chetna to you, sir. She says, RT-PCR first test negative preoperative, second test positive postoperative, explain. The second question from her says, quarantine to doctors after the exposure, what is it now?
See, the first question, RT-PCR is, again, like any other PCR test, it depends upon the time when the sample has been taken, the person who is taking the sample, and the method of this thing, and it can change from lab to lab. So I have seen situations where one laboratory is turned as positive, the other laboratory is come as negative, and the patient is completely fine, no symptoms. In these kind of situations, we send them home. So preoperative and postoperative, there I don't see any correlation in that. But again, if you have a strong suspicion clinically, or the patient is having a contact with a positive patient, then we'll have to be careful and not only go by the RT-PCR.
Exactly, sir. Sir, regarding the RT-PCR, the latest guideline says RT-PCR, it is not 100% specific and 100% sensitive. There is a possibility of the false negative in RT-PCR also. So that's why the famous virologist Jacob John said that even the clinical diagnosis is of most important, as Dr. Mahadevan has rightly pointed out, that one. The second thing, the question of doctor quarantine after seeing the positive patient, COVID-19 positive, only the primary contact. Suppose if the patient comes with the COVID-19, the doctors will be the primary contact. If the primary contact, because he is the vulnerable section, he is the frontline worker, so he must undergo the RT-PCR test. Suppose if it is if it comes as a positive, then according to the symptoms category, mild or moderate or severe, then we have to treat it accordingly. As Mahadevan rightly pointed out, even a mild cases, if a facility is available in your home, it can be isolated by providing the pulse oximeter and also the respiratory count. That is a two main criteria. If the pulse oximeter goes below less than 95 millimeter of mercury, then you must be alert. Because if it goes beyond, between the 95 to 100, you need not worry about it, sir.
Sir, as far as RT-PCR is concerned, make sure the lab, the technician takes the swab from both the places, nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal. I know for a doctor's husband, one technician took only from the nose. And the doctor had to tell him that, why are you taking like that? Then he corrected himself and took from two places. It happens sometimes. So make sure that it is taken from both the sides.
Sir, I have one request to Dr. Mahadevan.
Yes, sir.
Consider with the help of office bearers of IMA, have some small resource center for COVID for our branch members, because there are lots of, we are all getting bombarded with
patients. Yes, sir.
But for if we have to call up somebody and ask, so if you could set up, if you could consider providing some time for the branch, so that we could create a resource center, and we'll be very thankful if you could spearhead that.
Yes, sir. Definitely it should be considered, sir. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Mahadevan, because we had
Dr. Yumas wants to ask a question.
Okay, Yumas, go ahead, sir.
For an excellent presentation, and Dr. Meenakshi Sundaram,
yes, sir.
I just wanted to know, how many of your patients have neurological manifestations?
So far, I had two patients with neurological manifestations, sir.
What were they?
Out of this 500, one patient had an encephalopathic picture with a chronic myoclonic jerks.
Okay.
So the other patient had a kind of confusion and altered sensorium. So the first patient on repeated the MRI brain is completely normal. The second patient, tomorrow I'm planning to do for an MRI brain, sir. So it can be also an ICU psychosis, which is happening. The first patient completely recovered. And with our neurological team, we tried IVIG because the autoimmune panel turned out to be positive. But that patient also completely recovered out of that. Other than that, I did not have any patient with a stroke or MI or a CVT or any thromboembolic patients I have not seen, sir.
What autoimmune antibody was positive, sir?
I'll have to go through, sir. I'm not sure about that, but I'll get back to you after seeing that, sir.
Yeah, I'll be interested in mine. Thank you very much.
Definitely.